Good morning.
Good morning.
I don't know if you were like myself today. You feel like there's a big dark cloud hovering over you. I don't know if you looked in the bulletin today and seen the little picture I put up in the corner of a, like a man holding a huge rock over his head, carrying a load that he wasn't ever meant to carry in the first place. And today, as we're going to look at a psalmist who's got a big dark cloud over his head as well. But I was reminded as the psalmist sung for Amy that there's something about the name of Jesus. And when I heard that word come, that song played, I had in my mind a picture of the heaviness over my head, like a dark cloud. It was like right after a storm when the sunlight comes back out and the rays pierce back through. I could only think of, there's something about the name Jesus that when I'm faced with something more than I can carry, there's light. There's a hope. So if you would, please, if you're able to stand and rise to the reading of God's word, we'll be reading from Psalm 102. We looked at verse 12. That's Psalm 102, verse 12. This is strange that I'm only picking this one verse, but we'll be talking about the entire psalm, is that it's a transition point. It's a point, a turning point. So I don't know what you're facing here today. I don't know what gloom is over your head. I tell you what, this past week, mine, I feel like I've had a dark cloud over my head all week. Even this morning, even coming here, it just felt something heaviness. And Steve alluded to that earlier, but that's only a short period of time. There's hope when we're afflicted. But verse 12 says, "But thou, O Lord, shall endure forever, and thy remembrance unto all generations." Let us pray. Heavenly Father God, I know that people here today are carrying heavy burdens. They might mask it with a smile when they come in. They're dealing with something in their lives that's too much for them to bear. Your children are looking, God, to you, Father, for strength, support, perseverance, and endurance. And we know that you can only be the one to provide us with that, to calm the storms in our lives and restore peace to our hearts. God, my prayer is simple. Change our hearts. Change our minds. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't know if y'all like to watch Netflix, and I know I like to start out with movies. I don't know why the Lord's kind of getting me with watching television a lot. I was sitting there and I was flipping through Netflix, and I found a new series. It's called Anne with an E. It comes from a book called Anne of Green Gables. Maybe y'all have read this when you were younger in school, but the book is about a orphan girl who really never had the opportunity to be a child. This girl went through being a slave, basically, to those that she was entrusted with. They would send her out to a family's home, and the family would mistreat her. They would beat her. They put her into service. All she ever wanted was someone to love her and to accept her for who she was. This girl loved to talk. It's sort of like my daughters. They love to talk. And this little girl, she talks and talks and talks and talks. Sometimes to the point that my wife couldn't even watch it. She said, this annoys the tar out of me to see this girl talk. She was mistreated by her friends, the ones that were so-called her friends. She was mistreated by her teachers. She was mistreated by the community. But she had a ray of hope. It's sort of like the sun coming through the clouds. There was a family who was wanting a young boy to come to their farm and to help them with the farm duties they had. But the orphanage made a mistake and sent the girl. And I can remember as I was watching the movie is that she was traveling down the road and she was looking around and saw this beautiful pond with beautiful trees that were flowering. And was just in awe, and she was pinching herself the entire time saying, this can't be true. This can't be really happening to me. Finally getting a family who will take me in. And by the time she got back, she had a bruise on her arm. Only to hear the words, as you're not what we needed. We wanted a boy, not a girl. Her dreams were shattered. Pretty much crushed. But the family ended up taking her in anyway. And what I'm trying to get you to the point is that her only dream was to be loved and accepted. Even though she faced hardships in her life, the family asked her one day, would you like to become part of our family? And sign our Bible. Many of the older people in the church here know of your parents or your grandparents that had one of those huge Bibles that took up a whole counter that people wrote the family's names in. If there was a birth, it was added. If there was a death, it was added. If there was a marriage, it was added. And this young girl, who had lost all hope, but still had just an inkling that one day it would come true, was asked to sign her name with their last name. And you can imagine what joy it must have brought her to sit there and to write her name in the Bible and to be a part of something she had always hoped for. You got to see is that the journey of life is going to be ups and downs. Just my week this week has been like this. Up, down, spiritual high, spiritual low. Spiritual high, spiritual low. Things are going great. Things are going terrible. But when I sit here and I look at what the psalmist here went through, all we got to think is that my life is easy. Compared to the orphan that was searching for someone to love her and to care for her, someone who would listen to her. Remember I said she liked to talk a lot. How many of y'all have ever been in a conversation with somebody at work? They are just in there talking and your mind's elsewhere. Yeah, they're not really listening. Sorry, I do that to y'all too. No offense. Hopefully none taken. But anyway, I want you to know what's going on here before we begin. The psalmist is writing this during a time where the Israelites have been taken exile by the Babylonians. And we see that when they took probably from 14,000 to 18,000 people from their home place to Babylon. Now you got to understand this, what kind of impression, emotional distress would they have to go through to be taken from their home, first of all. Can you imagine someone coming to your house, grabbing you and your family, and taking you out the door, and while they are, they're taking and set your house on fire? Not only that, they took river rock and set them on fire too. The church, the building, the place where you went to worship God has now been destroyed along with your home. Or what about the capital of the United States? Imagine turning around and looking back and it's on fire too. You're no longer a nation anymore. You are being taken elsewhere. And while you're being taken, you're also looking around and seeing your own country
culture here. There was new religion here. But why in the world were they in this in the first place? It was because the Israelites would serve God for a short period of time, and then all of a sudden they switch their attention on to idols. They take their attention off of God and place it on other things, and God allowed the Babylonians to come in and to take this group of people who was God's people and allow them to be punished for a period of time. So you're in a new culture, your entire past is gone behind you. Even some of the friends that you knew, your home place, your comfort, your the security, every aspect of your life has now been put into shambles. And this psalmist is recounting all of this, and they're towards the end of the exile, and even maybe going back, some of them are already heading back to Jerusalem to rebuild during the time of Ezra and Nehemiah. Or they're rebuilding the walls of the temple. Can you imagine coming back and seeing the ruins of what was a glorious temple? And you look at the ruins of your home. What kind of emotional bear would you have to bear knowing that all these things have taken place? It was emotional. It was mental. Physical and spiritual. They were facing all these different aspects, and this psalmist teaches us that in times of affliction, if you have your bulletin with you today, I know we don't have it on the screen, the very first one, if in times of affliction, I cry out to God. In times of affliction, I cry out to God. If you would look with me here in Psalm 102, and we'd be looking at the first two verses, I want you to see is what did the psalmist do when he realized that he had hit rock bottom? What do we as Christians today, when we have hit rock bottom, when the burden of life is so heavy on us that we're unable to bear it, we cry out to God. Now I want you to look at this prayer is because the psalmist is not just praying an ordinary prayer. You've got to notice what he is saying here. There's five times he calls out to God to hear him. Look very closely with me. It says, "Hear my prayer, O Lord, and let thy cry come unto thee. Hide not thy face from me in day when I am in trouble. Incline thy ear unto me in the day when I call. Answer me speedily." Did you catch that? He was saying, "God, hear me. God, hear me. Hear me, God. Don't you? Are you not there? Hear me. I'm going through something I cannot bear. Where are you?" But if you look here, you got to find out is why is he crying out to God? What's going on in his life that he feels that he has got to cry out not one time, not two times, but five times for God to hear him and to answer him? Look with me in verses 3 and 4. In verses 3 and 4 it says, "For my days are consumed like smoke, and my bones are burned as in the hearth. My heart is smitten and withered like grass, so that I forgot to eat my bread." Also in verse 11 it says, "My days are like a shadow that declineth, and I am withered like grass." Verse 23 and 24 it says, "He weakened my strength in the way. He shortened my days. I said, Oh my God, take not away in the midst of my days thy years throughout all generations." What he's looking at is he's saying that my life here on this earth is short. Now I want you to think about it. As opposed to eternity, your life is like a vapor. James points it out very clearly that my life is like a vapor. It's here 1 minute and gone the next. To give you an example is I took my children and my wife camping, tent camping, and they survived. They did. I helped with that.
and I asked my daughters to go get wood for the fire so I could cook the breakfast and the dinner. And they would bring me these little boards that I had cut and had prepared for the fire. They're all the same length. You can tell my perfectionism, they had to be exactly the same length, same width. We put them on there, and you know what would happen as I put them on there? Them things would burn up like that. The little thin boards. You know, you gotta start out with little boards and then work your way up to the big logs. Well, we kept working through them and we started putting on there and we noticed tonight. The girl was saying, man, it gets smoky out here. And I said, yeah, smoke follows good looks. That's why I kept following me. But it would kept going up in smoke. And I'd always have to say to them, I'd say, Hannah, run back to the car and please give me some more of the wood out of the back. And she'd come back with three or four more boards. We'd throw them on there and in no time, be gone. The psalmist is painting the picture here is that he's recognized that his life here on earth is short. And when you start doing that, and as the older I'm getting, and I looked at my grandmother, she just turned 93 about a couple weeks or so ago. You think as you're getting older, my life is doing what? It's getting shorter. Uh-oh. My life is but like a baby. And he recognized that. So you got to think is that he was thinking about, you know, I'm approaching death. You know, something that, here comes that cloud again. Now, I'm going to put a big black cloud over your head for a little while, but no, it's not going to be there forever. You got to catch what he was doing because you are just like the psalmist. There's good points in your life and there's low points in your life. First of all, you start recognizing, wait a minute, my life is getting shorter and shorter. From the day I was born, the clock started ticking. It's moving closer to the death side. But not only that, is that he says that he is physically sick. Look at verse 5. It says, for by reason of the voice of my groaning, my bones cleave to my skin. Have y'all ever had a fever in your life? You ever had one that maybe brought your temperature up, maybe around 104? Have you ever had one that burned so deeply it said it burned deeply down to my bones? The psalmist is recognizing that he also is physically sick. And he's sick to the point, as we look into prior verses, it says he was sick at the thought that he was physically ill, but also at the shortness of his life, looking at his past and what had taken place in there, and was being weighed down by it. And he said that it made him to where he couldn't even eat. Have you ever been sick to the point you couldn't eat? That's a pretty bad feeling when you're sick. I hate being sick. I'm like a big baby when I get sick. It's like, I'm sick, help me out. But there's times when you start thinking about this thing or you start worrying, and Steve used a good point a while ago, is that a lot of us here are probably today with anxiety. If you have never suffered that, it's awful. If you never experienced a panic attack, it's terrible. Sometimes it's unbearable. You don't know what to do. Your emotions are just scrambled up. Your mental ability to think clearly is completely messed up. And that's what happens whenever we allow these things in our lives to take over. And that's easy to do. Let me tell you, and I probably got to do much convincing to let you know is that when you start pondering on these things, they get worse and worse and worse. Because you're thinking about what you can do. Who's in control of the situation? And guess what? You're not in control. Your control is in the wrong place. Your focus is off. He's physically sick. He's looking at the shortness of the life. But he also says he felt alone. Look with me in verse 6 and 7. I am like a pelican of the wilderness. I am like an owl of the desert. I watch and I am a sparrow alone atop of the roof housetop. Has there ever been a time in your life when you got to be so bad that you felt like you're the only one that is going through this type of situation and there's no one else that can bring you comfort and joy and peace during these times because you're the only one that's going through it? Now, I'll tell you the truth is that the Bible says that Elijah was very, very much the same way. Y'all remember Elijah? He called down fire from heaven. He had to burn up the altar. He slew all the false And just after that, after this spiritual high with God, he's at a spiritual low, and he's in a cave, cowering, saying, God, where are you? I'm here by myself. I'm all alone. Have you forgotten me, God? Don't you care that I'm going through this? Don't you care that I feel like nobody knows what's going on in my life right now? And I thought the best part was that he tried to find it in other things. Remember there was a big earthquake? Oh, maybe God's in this big earthquake over here. Oh, maybe he's in the wind over here. But where did they find God at? But if you look at that same passage where Elijah is sitting there crying out to God, there's two times he repeated the same things. And that the people around me had forsaken you, they had torn down the altars, and that I am all alone. Well, you and I feel this sometimes myself. I feel like nobody really knows what it's like to have a heart attack unless you've had one. You don't know what I go through on a daily basis, mentally. What I have to deal with. And maybe you're out here with a sickness and illness yourself, and you're saying, you know something? Your heart attack's all right, but you don't know what I've got going on in my life. And this was this song is saying, you know, I'm all alone, I'm physically sick, and I'm looking around, and my life is nothing but a vapor. But on top of that, you ever just had something go wrong at your house? Then another thing. You look around, there's about 10 things that just happened within about 1 week span. Got a flat tire, the washer's going out, the roof's leaking, all these things are going on right now in my life. Golly. Add injury to insult right here. It says that his enemies mocked him. Now you gotta see, who is his enemies? His enemies are the Babylonians, but it's also some of the people who had adapted to the culture that they were in. They had given up their roots in faith in God and started worshiping idols there. So they were being mocked by not only the people they were taken captive by, but also some of their own people. Ain't that just a slap in the face? Well, wait a minute. You think that's enough for this guy right here? Oh no, get started right here now. He also feels that he is suffering unjustly. Ooh, amen. We learned about that this morning, about pride in our lives, didn't we? If y'all ever get a chance, please come into our thing. We're having a great discussion on pride. If you feel like you need to be beaten down, we're glad to oblige you. God will give you a real dose of reality when you come in there. I tell you what, the people in there, we had a dark cloud lingering over us. I think that's why I'm still carrying when I come in here. Rich, I know you are. You still got your over your head, too. Everybody in there. But to add injury to insult, he's feeling like he's suffering injustice. And it brought to mind one of the characters that you know from the Bible very well. How many of y'all remember the man named Job? Oh my gosh. You think you've got it bad in your life? Let me give you a dose of reality right here. He was standing here. Just imagine a normal day was going by. You know, he's on a spiritual high. Everything's going well. He's blessed. He's got family. He's got flocks. He's got servants. He's got good health. He's got everything going for him. Satan goes to God and says, the only reason he still follows you is because he blessed him. I bet you take away all those things, he'll curse you. Do what you want for him. Amen. Did God say that? Do what you want for him, but don't take his life. They come and they're taken by another nation. Wait a minute, this sounds very familiar. And all the servants were killed. And while that guy had just finished, here comes another guy. Hey, they've taken all the Babylonians and taken all of our camels. And they've stolen all of our servants, and I'm the only one left. How about somebody feeling all alone? These are the guys that are running back. Oh, well, that was going on. Wait a minute. The wind blew down the house and killed your family. And while that was going on, guess what? Your health just went bad. He's sitting in ashes. Now, this is a sign of deep distress.
Now, I think Americans today is that we sit in our ashes mourning and griping over the situation we're in. This is some bad stuff that Psalms is seeing and going through. Can you imagine how it's affecting him physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually? Nothing's left. Nothing. Then verse 12 comes along. Oh, here you go. Ready for your light to come through the dark cloud? Here you go. But God. Do I have to say any more but God? So in times of affliction, I cry out to God. Here's your second one for your life. You just want to take notes. In times of affliction, I turn to God. In times of affliction, I turn to God. And I was just mindful to think of is that, you know, we always use the term storms for things going on in our lives. I've got a lot of storms. My daughter runs. They come up on the news, let me tell you, she's just underneath the couch crying. Because it brings her anxiety. And I used to laugh at that, and I was wrong by doing that. Because I don't know the emotional strain that she was under. The burden that she was carrying it so heavy that she couldn't bear. But I'm mindful to think of a man named Peter. There's a man in the Bible whose name's Peter. I think he was mentioned at the top of the disciples list numerous times, the one that we'll build our church on. He's also the one that was in a storm. Now, you know, like storms, being out on the ocean? Ever been out in deep sea fishing in a storm? It's awful, dude. I don't see how these Navy men do it. I mean, boom, storm. The ship's beating right and left. You know, these are men who knew about fishing that faced storm before, and they're looking out there, and all of a sudden here comes someone walking across the water to them. First of all, that's scary enough as it is, but what do you do? That's hard enough for me to imagine. I'm out there in the middle of nowhere, and all of a sudden, dude can walk across the road. But we see Christ walking up across to them. We got to remember is that the disciples was never out of the view of God. That's good for you and I, is that when I'm going through these trials and tribulations of my life, I'm not out of the view of God. Now, he's still caring. But he said, if that is you, let me walk out there. What? Step out of the boat? Are you crazy? You see the storm going on there? But he had enough gall to ask him, and he said, all right, I'm on out here. You met in that first step? You ever see the cat test in the water? he tested the water, but, and his focus, now you got to see here, is that his focus was on Christ. And when his focus was on Christ, what happened to the other things that were going on? It didn't matter anymore. His eyes, his focus, his attention was on Christ. And he started walking toward him. But the moment that he took his eyes off him, oh, wait a minute, my health, bad eye, man, I got bad heart. Oh man, I got bad finances. Man, the collector's calling me. The phone's ringing, the head's stopped ringing. Oh, the car's broke down. Oh, the marriage is falling apart. All these things are going on at one time. But he starts thinking about it. Did you notice what Christ did? He didn't leave him where he was. This is also good news for us is that he reaches down and pulls us back up. His we were not out of his sight. He still cared for his child that was sinking. You know, when I cry out to God, sometimes I say, you know, it's bouncing off the roof and coming back most of the time. And I'll tell you why. It's because when I really started examining this passage, I started seeing, and this is important to Stephen enough to bring our churches, that we need to know the doctrine of God. Right. Who God is. And I'll tell you what, this the author here is, you know, he's unknown, but he gives us a clear picture of the doctrine of God, who God is. When we take the tension off self, there's our pride thing for us again. For those who are going through the pride book, and put it on God, things start to change. Notice what it says right here in verse 12. But thou, O Lord, shall endure forever, and thy remembrance unto all generations. He is painting us a picture of an eternal God that has no beginning and no end. This is good
for me to know is that the God that I am serving, the God that I place my trust in, is eternal. There's no beginning, there's no end. There's just one aspect. Watch as they start building on each other. He's also a sovereign God. Look at verse 13. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to her favor, yea, the set time has come. He's also the King of Kings in 15. So the heathen shall fear the name of the Lord, and all the kings of the earth thy glory. Verse 16, he's a coming God. When the Lord shall build up Zion, he shall appear in his glory. Verse 17, he is a God who listens. He will regard the prayer of the destitute and not despise their prayer. Verse 19, he's an overseeing God. For he hath looked down from the height of his sanctuary, from heaven did the Lord behold the earth. He is also our creator. Verse 25, of old thou hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are thy work of thy hands. He's an unchanging God in verse 26 and 27. They shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all them shall wax old like an old garment, as a vesture shalt thou change them, and they shall be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years shall have no end. When we look at who he is, he's the overseeing God. He is the God who listens. He is God who is not that I can get out of his presence. He is one who has never forsaken me. The only one he has forsaken is his own son, who took the penalty on the cross for each and every one of our sins. He is the God who loved us because he sent that son. He is the God who cared for us, that he started his plan of redemption from the very beginning and will fulfill it at the end. He is the God who is coming again and will receive his children to himself again. He has taken us to a place that he has not been made with hands, that we will be in his presence, and we shall dwell with him in the house of the Lord forever. What kind of God is this? That he loved me while I was yet a sinner. And he has not forsaken me because he has put the Holy Spirit in me, who has sealed me. You want a picture of the doctrine of God? Look at that. Look at what he's trying to paint a picture for you here. When he turned his eyes out there, he was able to walk on the water. He was able to bear what he was going through. Because he found out who God was. He remembered. I don't know about you, I can't remember what I did 5 minutes ago. But it's good to know that when I come back to this psalm and I refresh my mind, is that the problems of the earth seem to fade away whenever. They seem to dissolve like snow, like the one psalm used to say. But also, in Psalm 55:22, is that when we're going through these heavy things, there's a way that we can handle it. It says, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. That's good news for me. I get moved whenever I start looking at my own emotions. I get moved when I start looking at my situation. But when I look at an unchanging God, whose plan and promise for me is for eternity, whom shall I fear? What shall I fear? My heart attack, who cares? It's nothing. My financial needs, it's nothing. No matter my anxiety, nothing. It says be anxious for nothing. Why? Because look who God is. But he also says is that in times of affliction, now this is important for your church right here. In times of affliction, I focus on others. Wait a minute. When my attention is off self and on God first, the next step becomes super easy because I attend to the needs of others. Look at what they did in West Virginia. They sacrificed their time with their family. They sacrificed their money. They sacrificed the things that they carried there for the benefit of somebody else. If you have never done that before, go out today, just today, and do something for somebody nice. But you got to see, is that nice? That's not what he's saying right here. He wants, those are good things, but he's saying is that my focus has got to be on others, but it's specific. He is specifically praying for Jerusalem. Now, Steve told me a pretty fascinating statistic is that the area of Concord and Kannapolis, I think, was in the top 40 of lostness. How many of y'all live in Kannapolis? Raise your hand. Concord? Guess what? You're living in an area where the most part of the biggest part of the area is lost. What you gonna do about it? Where is your focus right now? Is it still on God, but not out of the pew seats right here? Or the auditorium seats? It says, look at verse 13. He says he's looking at the condition of the Jerusalem. He's saying, look at what this place, remember, it was torn down. The people has been murdered. We have people who are going through emotional, physical, and spiritual problems. And he starts praying for them. So our first concern as believers is that we have got to be praying for the city around us. It says, verse 13 and 14. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to favor her. Yea, the set time has come. For thy servants take pleasure in her stones and the favor of the dust thereof. They were still considered that rubble that used to be the temple to be sacred ground. Whether it was in ruin or not, this was sacred to them. And he started praying is that we not only need to be praying for the lost, but we also need to be praying for revival amongst those who are in the church today. Our churches are becoming dead. And if you look at our churches, they're declining. Look at how many churches are shutting down the doors because there's no longer anybody to come in to fulfill the building. He said, not only that, I've got to look at is that the condition of the people who are around me. He talks about the Gentiles, he says, in verse 15. So the heathen shall fear the name of the Lord and all the kings of the earth thy glory. Verse 21 and 22. To declare the name of the Lord in Zion and to praise in Jerusalem when the people are gathered together in the kingdoms to serve the Lord. He's looking at the Gentiles, which is anybody but Israelites. And he's saying, you know something? Not only is our city lost, but the people are lost. And what that leads to is the next problem is that we've got to be praying for the future church. And I think that was one of our songs. I can't remember what the name of it was called. I can't remember what we were singing. It was talking about the future of our church. Anybody remember? Rise Up? Rise Up? Yeah. While he's looking at them, he is saying is that we need to be looking at the condition of the people around us, our cities, and our youth has started taking steps towards that. I know a lot of y'all don't know what goes on in the youth over there, and we're trying not to lead them too far astray. But Rich had a great idea. He had a great idea one day is that we are going to come into our youth group. They're going to go to the Joshua Project. Joshua Project is praying for and aiding these lost countries that have less than 1% from a lot of them of Christians and pray for them. And our youth did a great job as they went and they picked a people group that they had no idea who they are and began praying for them. When's the last time we have looked at our city and looked at the people that are actually in it and noticed that they're not like us anymore? They're a different culture, a different nationality. And the psalmist is saying, you know what? When I got my eyes on myself and I focus in on God, then I started focusing on His mission. What was our mission given to us? Go ye therefore unto all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them all things I have commanded. I think we get to the God part and we forget the rest of it. We don't move forward and take steps for our future church. I want you to think about this. Look at the youth in our church now. How many would say there are less than 10 between our youth and children? That's our future church.
That's right.
Look at the numbers of them right now. If we don't ingrain it to them, they're not going to be able to ingrain it up. One day, guess what? That's sad to say, but like the song said, life is short. We're not going to be here forever. We've got to pass it to our future church. But I thought this was very cool is that the last thing that we need to look at is that
In times of affliction, I have hope.
Here comes your grace of life.
Verse 28. The children of thy servants shall continue, their seed shall be established before thee. In Jeremiah 33:16, it says, in those days Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem shall dwell safely. And this is the name wherewith she shall be called, the Lord our righteousness. In Psalm 23, verse 6, how many of y'all have heard Psalm 23? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You remember what the last verse of that is? Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell where? We have a hope. We may be facing those tough times in life, but we have Christ who has died for us. Who, if you place your faith and turn away from your sin and turn towards God, is that we can have what has been promised, eternal life, and we will have it. Notice this. I think about hell, how bad the flames can be, but what's worse than that is be in absence of the presence of God, but to be in a place where He will be forever, and we shall dwell with Him, not just for a week, not just a month, but forever and ever and ever. It brings me hope. And as I look at the story of Anne, I bring it back to the Anne of Green Gables. He says that right there, that part where she's signing the Bible. Can you imagine all her past that she knew of, the mistreatment, the servitude, the rejection, now has turned to acceptance, loved, a part of a family, and how long will it be remembered? It's written in their book, which is only earthly. But imagine our name that's written in the book of life, which is eternal. So we went from a dark cloud over our head back to where we should be. So what have we learned through this is that in times of affliction, I call out to God. I do what next? I turn to who? Then I do what? I focus on? And I still have. Now remember what my prayer was at the very beginning? Change our hearts. Change our minds. Well, that's how it's done. Of what God has revealed to us through what the psalmist has done. But I can't help but leave us with an invitation that Rich gave the other day from Matthew 11. Come unto me, all ye that are laboring and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know something, that guy carrying a rock on your bulletin? That rock has been cast out through the universe. Not by history, but what God did. So I don't know where you're at today. I don't know what dark clouds over your head. But I know we don't have a formal altar, but while we're here, this is a formal altar. If you need to come, you need to talk to God, please do. There's no one here to make fun of you. If you want to come up here, if they do, they're the one with the problem, not you. Never be afraid. And it's okay to pray at your seats as well, but there's nothing special like laying it down at the altar. So if you need to come, please come at this time. Dear Heavenly Father God, Lord, sometimes our lives are just full of burdens. Things that have been placed upon us that are too heavy for us to carry. But God, you are great when we put our focus on you. We stop our sinking and put back the solid ground. Lord, I pray if there's anyone in here today that's going through something that may be too big for them to carry, that they will know that Christ gives life. You are God who cares about us.
forgiveness. And when we do, Lord, that burden is lifted. Just as my soul has been lifted this morning, reflecting on who you are. Thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.